I'd like to welcome all of you. My name is David Beck. I'm a colorectal surgeon from the Oxford Clinic in New Orleans. I'm very honored to introduce our speaker today. The Abcarian lecture was sponsored by the Colorectal Society of Chicago in 2006. The idea was to honor Dr. Herand Abcarian and address relevant and emerging issues in surgery. The 2018 lecture will be the 12th lecture in the series. As chairman, the speaker is selected by the advisory committee of the American College of Surgeons for Colorectal Surgery. As chairman, I get to present the speaker. Members of this committee represent most of the major interests in colorectal surgery and the college. Dr. Abcarian, our speaker honoring today, is truly a master colorectal surgeon. For over 40 years, he's inspired trainees in general surgery and colorectal surgery, as well as mentored many people in this audience, including myself. He received his medicine degree from Tehran University, then went to Cook County, where he did his general surgery and colorectal training. He continued at Cook County, eventually being chief of surgery at that institution. He served as both the president of our society, the president of the board, and for many years was the executive director of the American Board of Colorectal Surgery. He's extensively published, done significant research, and anybody who spent time with him at a meeting or at dinner knows he has varied interests. He has an unusual intellect and can kind of pierce through to the core of matter in a very succinct and enjoyable manner. And we're certainly honored that he is the subject of this lectureship. Our speaker today is Dr. Zane Cohen. Zane got his MD from the University of Toronto, did his residency in general surgery training at Toronto General Hospital, and then serves as a registrar at both St. Mark's and London Hospital. He's done extensive research. He has over 250 peer-reviewed publications and is well known in our specialty. Eventually, he was the head division chief of general surgery at Toronto General, surgeon in chief in Mount Sinai, the program director of the colorectal residency, and more recently has now become the director of the Zane Cohen Centre, which is involved in research and specialization. Despite all his major professional accomplishments, Zane did have some time for a balanced life with his spouse and an occasional time for an adult beverage. And though he's a major figure in colorectal surgery, reality has a way of kind of getting us back to, there we go, okay. All right, this is a recent picture at a Crohn's and colitis facility. This is Zane with two of the Canadian football players, which kind of gives you a new perspective on life in general. So I'm very pleased to introduce our 2018 Herand Abcarian speaker, Dr. Zane Cohen.
Well, thank you, David, and very much for the introduction. And thank you all for coming. It's certainly a privilege and an honor to give this Harry Abcarian lecture. That picture that you saw makes me look like an absolute midget beside two football players. But the fellow on the left actually is a center for one of the Canadian football teams. And we did a pouch on him. And he was a very affable guy, and he became the host of the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation Gala in Winnipeg, Manitoba, for about 4 years in a row. He invited me to come out there. And I went out there, and he sat me with all these football players, and it was like I disappeared at the table, for sure. Absolutely disappeared at the table. But it is certainly a, well, that's another picture of me, but I need my my slides now, so I'll just go through them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. This is it?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So as I look out in the audience, I see that I know about 90% of the people sitting here, and including Herand, who's in the first row here. And this is Herand at a master class in colon and rectal surgery in Europe, which he usually attends on a yearly basis. And the speakers that have given this particular lectureship over the years, and I'm pleased to say that I'm the third member from the University of Toronto to give this talk. Robin McLeod, who's in the audience, as well as Richard Resnick, have preceded me. And when I saw this theme of the 2018 American College of Surgeons Clinical Congress, Joy and Privilege of a Surgical Career, it made me think about what could I say that would fit in with this particular theme. And I hope that in the next several minutes, or more than several minutes, I hope that I will have accomplished that. But before I do that, I have to say that last night I was out with three colleagues at from Mount Sinai Hospital, and Helen McRae, who's here, and Aaron Kennedy, who's here, Alexander Eason. And I posed the question to them, and I said, what does it mean to you, this theme of the American College of Surgeons, joy and privilege of a surgical career? And we had a very interesting conversation. I don't think there's any doubt at all that tremendous privilege to be a surgeon. When you think about a patient who is sitting across from you for about 20 or 30 minutes and then they entrust their whole body to you, that is something that we should never, ever forget as a surgeon or as an individual, to entrust themselves to you to do any kind of small or major complicated operation on them. That is certainly a privilege which we all have. And that privilege comes with a certain amount of responsibility. And therefore, my talk is entitled Privilege and Responsibility, a 20-year journey. Now, why is that? Well, the journey is ongoing. And it really started more than 20 years ago, but it is the 20 years that I really want to talk to you about. I have no financial disclosures, but I do disclose that I am a Lynch syndrome family member. And the first part of my talk, I want to talk to you about what is involved when you are a Lynch syndrome family member. I'm going to introduce you to some of my family, and we will go from there. So this is as far back as I could get a picture of my grandparents, whom I never knew, my father, who is on the right side here, and his siblings are in the back. He had a brother and two sisters, and this picture was taken in the Ukraine. The brother on the left-hand side died early on of tuberculosis, and the two boys traveled from or left the Ukraine and came to Canada. The two sisters went to Tel Aviv. That is, the picture is about 100 years old. And so the family started out in Kiev, two of them came to Toronto, two went to Tel Aviv, and from the Israeli family, some of the children went to Los Angeles, other children went to São Paulo, Brazil. And I have now visited as many of the family members as I was able to do in all of these four different places. This is my niece, Karen, and this is partly her story. So in 1998, 20 years ago, she had about a year's history of menorrhagia with multiple biopsies taken, and nothing could be found until late on in her history. when she finally was found to have dysplasia, not carcinoma, but dysplasia in the endometrium. And so after a time, it was decided that she needed an operation, and she went to the Toronto General Hospital, across the road from Mount Sinai Hospital, and was operated upon there by one of the gynae oncologists, as well as a uro-oncologist. And I happened to be there in the waiting room with my sister, waiting for the result of this procedure. And about an hour and a half into the procedure, the two surgeons came out to speak to my sister and to myself. And they said, and this is an absolutely true story, exactly how it happened. And they said, she has metastatic disease in her pelvis, and we think the thing to do for her is to close her and to offer her chemotherapy. And I said to both of them, almost immediately, why are you going to do that? And they said, because we think that this is the best thing for her. This was 1998, remember? We think this is the best thing for her at the time. And we don't really want to do a pelvic node dissection. And I said to them, this is localized disease in the pelvis. We should try to take this out. And we went back and forth for about 10 or 15 minutes in the waiting room. And finally, they said, okay, we'll compromise, and we will biopsy her periaortic node. And if that node is positive, we are doing nothing else. But if that node is negative, we will do a pelvic node dissection. Well, they did do the node. It was negative. They did do the pelvic node dissection. And 20 years later, after an anterior excentration, here she is. They tested her tumor, and she had Lynch. And that really set me off. The whole experience of having that, not knowing what was happening in our whole family, being a surgeon, having the privilege and the responsibility of operating on so many people, and yet I didn't know exactly what was going on in my own family. I felt really terrible, and it really made me think and feel in 1998 that the thing that I had to do was to find out what is going on with our whole extended family. What is there? Who is involved? Who had cancer? Who had MSH2 in Lynch? Who had this? And so I set out to do this pedigree, which is now our family. And I want to take you through some of this and show you exactly how this developed and how actually what you can learn from your own family that can be transposed into your thinking about how you handle patients with Lynch syndrome. So from this larger family now, in red are patients who did develop cancer. In blue are the carriers, and in green are those who are negative, in white not tested. Of course, we couldn't test everybody because people had died and their tumors weren't available, but some were many years later for us to do. And in the white triangles or squares, those were not tested. And of course, like in any genetic disease, there are patients who do not want to hear or know about what's going on in the family. And so some patients, some family members actually refused testing. And what I'm going to do is branch off each of these sections so we can see this in a little more detail and try to put this together. So the eldest member was a cousin of my father's, but before we do this, just take a look at, if I can get this, it's not very bright, but that whole generation of my family had cancer, starting starting up here, rectal cancer, colorectal cancer, gallbladder cancer, and my father had both ulcerative colitis over a long period of time and developed two cancers in his colon, which we thought were related to his ulcerative colitis, but later found out that he was gene positive as well. And so we were able to still find the tumor from 1985 when my father's cousin was had her colon cancer. In 1985 at Mount Sinai Hospital, they still had the tumor to test. And of course, she was positive. And then in our own family, immediate family, my father at the top, two colorectal cancers in with a 15 to 20 year history of ulcerative colitis. And my sister, who is now 80 years old, who is a carrier, but has not expressed a cancer. On the other hand, she had a hysterectomy when she was younger, and it could be that if she didn't have that, she may have developed an endometrial cancer. She is still tested on a yearly basis. And then, of course, my niece, whose story you've heard, is well now 20 years later after her surgery. And the children of my sister and her grandchildren, the younger ones have not been tested yet. They don't need to be tested, not all of them. But my niece's child is now 13, and she will have to come up for testing. And if we go to the family that came from Israel to the U.S., there was rectal cancer, and there was rectal cancer in these patients who I really didn't know about until I started to go into this family history. And the son, who is right over here, he has refused to be tested. And inheritable diseases, some patients do not want to know. There are insurance issues with some patients that they don't want to have that known to insurers. And I have not been able to convince him, despite many trips out to see him, I have not been able to convince him to be tested. And then there is my other cousin who is a carrier of the gene, and she has a son who had a huge villous tumor and had a right hemicolectomy for that. He did not have a cancer, but he would have developed a cancer for sure. But in addition to Lynch, they have a polymorphism in their family of the APC gene. It's in Ashkenazi Jews, which gives them the development of adenomas in this part of the family. So they all have to be watched, and three of them have already developed a number of polyps, and they are watched every single year. And the family in Israel and in Brazil, there's an interesting 50-year-old who has developed endometrial and ovarian cancer, but the parents are negative for the gene. So in that particular case, they have developed a general population cancer. She has developed a general population cancer, as far as we know, and does not have the gene, and her seven children there have not been tested. So what should we know? The story of our family is one that is probably not unique to maybe even individuals sitting in this room, but it was so emotional for me as a surgeon, as I said before, knowing a fair amount of things and yet not knowing exactly what was going on in our whole family. And therefore, I felt that it was my absolute responsibility to find this out and to take care of the family. And that is part of why I named this talk the way I did. So what should we know a little bit about the epidemiology, the risk and surveillance guidelines according to the mutation? Surgical options, there aren't that many, and prevention. So this is a pie graph of the hereditary colon cancer patient, potentially with Lynch syndrome occupying about 3% of hereditary cancer, but all of the other heritable diseases, including FAP, hamartomatous polyposis, serrated or mixed polyposis, and other recessive conditions as well, which make up potentially 5%. But as I will show you, I think that this is an undercall, and we will be seeing more patients with these heritable cancer syndromes, depending on how they're analyzed. But with multi-gene panel testing, these kinds of genes come up all the time. And so I do believe that this is a tremendous undercall of these heritable conditions, and particularly Lynch. So Lynch syndrome is an inherited cancer susceptibility syndrome named after Henry Lynch. It's characterized by familial clustering of cancers. Familial clustering is an interesting topic because Andrew Worthen in 1913 wrote a paper about familial clustering, and it was completely discounted. He wrote another paper in 1926, and again about familial clustering, completely discounted. And so it's not as if familial clustering in these cancer syndromes was not known before. It's an autosomal dominant genetic defect in mismatch repair genes, and these are the main ones, MLH1, MSH2, MSH6, PMS2, and EpCAM. And the way to show this is now with immunohistochemistry staining, which in our institution is done universally for all colon cancers and also for endometrial cancers under the age of 70. It's not universal in respect to all institutions around North America doing it. There are costs with this, but it is one of the best ways to show when you can stain these tumors for normal staining or for loss of staining, which would indicate loss of that particular gene. In Ontario, the institutions are paying for this at about $150 a patient, but through Cancer Care Ontario, starting, I believe, in December or January, this will be picked up by the province, and the universal testing will be done. And it's become the standard of care to identify Lynch syndrome risk and possible treatment options, such as immunotherapy, which now is used as a second line of treatment for some solid tumors, very effective in some, and in particular in some with metastatic disease. It is not 100% effective because some of these deficiencies can be seen in somatic losses of mismatch repair genes, but it does allow you to do further testing, and testing in for these particular genes is really sequencing and now multi-panel testing, where we are seeing forms of the disease at an increased rate. The Lynch syndrome itself, the most common pathogenic variant is MSH2. We have about 220 families, 749 individuals that we are following, and in total, with all of these genes, there are close to 600 families and 1,700 patients that we are following in our center. Now, the risk and surveillance for colorectal cancer in Lynch and for non-colonic cancers associated with Lynch syndrome, there are many, many organizations who have written guidelines as to how to follow these particular patients. The National Collaborative Cancer Network, American Society of Clinical Oncology, the ASCRS, Cancer Care Ontario, the European Expert Guidelines, and the AGA, ACG, and ASGE. All of them have produced guidelines, but the guidelines, I have to say, I'm going to show you as one because they're pretty similar when you look at all of them together. So the cancer risk up to age 70 in individuals with Lynch compared to the general population. And on the left side, you can see, and one of the points that I want to get across is, there are multiple associated cancers that are associated with Lynch syndrome. And I think it's our responsibility to know that these cancers can occur in association with Lynch syndrome. So that if you see somebody, like one of the aunt that I had in Israel had gallbladder cancer. Is that an associated cancer with Lynch? Well, possibly. We never got an opportunity to test her. And her children, there are no carriers. So likely it was not a Lynch cancer. But it's possible that it could have been. And others who have gallbladder cancer shouldn't just discount it as a gallbladder cancer. There may be one of the associated cancers with Lynch syndrome, and you have to know about these things. So that it can be colon, endometrium, stomach, ovary, hepatobiliary tract, all of these. And this slide really demonstrates the general population risk for these. I think that from the NCCN, general population risk of colon cancer at 4.5%. I don't think that that's right, but certainly in the Canadian statistics, we're looking at about 6.5%. About 1 in 15 people have colon cancer in the general population. But if you look at the MLH1 or MSH2 risks, you can see that up to 50 to 80%, and these figures are not exactly accurate, as you can tell from the range of 50 to 80%, that these patients have a very high rate of developing colon cancer, and in particular, endometrial cancer. The other cancers involved are much less of a risk, but please be assured that all of these associated cancers have a higher risk than in the general population, and something that you should absolutely know about. And this is the same risk stratification based on the gene involved in a graph form, where you can see that MLH1 in pink and MSH2, or MSH2, I should say, have a much higher risk stratification in these particular diseases. And the risk of colorectal cancer after endometrial cancer is also extremely high. So as in our family, where the index case really was my niece who developed endometrial cancer, that's not the end of the game. The end of the game is to know what cancers are associated, to continue to follow these patients. We haven't got good follow-up for a lot of these cancers, but for some of them, such as endometrial in particular, the risk of developing a colorectal cancer 20 years later is close to 50%. So that is something that we should obviously remember and know about. So what is the Lynch Syndrome Management Guideline? It's a conglomeration of all the organizations that I mentioned. The screening colonoscopy for colorectal cancer is recommended in persons at risk, obviously. First-degree relatives of known MMR pathogenic carriers who have not had genetic testing or affected with Lynch syndrome. It could be beginning at ages 20 to 25 or 2 to 5 years before the youngest age of diagnosis. But it's not for all the genes. So if you know genes and you know that the prevalence of MLH1 and MSH2 are higher, and then they have to be tested more frequently. The expression of some of these other genes, MSH6 and PMS2, are much less. So you can be carriers without actually expressing the cancer. And maybe, and the cancer is not expressed as rapidly. So maybe in those particular cases, the follow-up can be a little bit less. So it's not one shoe fits all. It's knowing what to do for each particular gene. And the evidence for the colon cancer guideline, the characteristics are that there's a younger age of presentation. A lot of them are on the right side. There is a rapid growth with a shorter time before malignant transformation. And there still is a missed rate in colonoscopy of 5 to 10%. So that gets to what do you do about these tumors, what operations do you do, and I'll get to that in a few minutes. This is further proof of what you can do with screening. And although a lot of these studies are observational, they all seem to show the same thing, that in screened patients, the rate of developing colorectal cancer is much less. And if we go down to the Dove Edwin, this in 2005, it's at least a prospective observational evaluation, estimated 72% decrease in colorectal cancer deaths in screened individuals. For gynecologic cancer, the screening should be offered to women at risk or affected by Lynch syndrome. And ovarian cancer screening as well should be offered by transvaginal ultrasound annually starting at age 35. In endometrial cancer, at least there is risk-reducing surgery. So the recommendations of these guidelines is to do hysterectomies by age 40, as the cancer risk significantly increases after age 40. And in my sister, if you look back at the pedigree, that she had an early hysterectomy and never expressed a cancer after that, but was a carrier, and likely, or maybe, she would have expressed an endometrial cancer had she not had a hysterectomy. So the non-colonic, non-gynecologic cancers associated with Lynch syndrome, you've seen the left-hand side before, and the screening is a bit all over the place and not very accurate. So for gastric cancer, screening by esophagogastrectomy, gastroscopy, and duodenoscopy should be considered at age 30 to 35, at least as a baseline. But it's also dependent on the population that you're dealing with. So in North America, probably one baseline screening is enough. But in Asian populations where the cancer may be more common, then a more defined screening protocol is probably necessary. There's no real screening recommendation for small bowel, for pancreas, for breast, brain. A breast screening yearly is a general population. And for HPV screening, not really recommended. But it should be kept in the back of your mind that these are potentially associated cancers with Lynch syndrome. So I'm going to talk a little bit about surgical options to this audience, obviously, that I believe that extended resections are preferable, as metachronous tumors are pretty common. And I will show you the evidence for metachronous tumors that occur in Lynch. What I can't show you is that in our own center, almost all the operations have been segmental resections initially, followed at some point by if there's a development of a metachronous tumor, then a more extended procedure is undertaken. So in our series, there is close to 250 patients who, as their first operation, had a right hemicolectomy. Some had anterior resection, iliorectal anastomosis, and the list drops off from there. So how can I tell you that you should be doing an extended resection when I'm showing you that our results show that the right hemicolectomy is the most common operation? And it's the most common operation because it's the most common site of developing a cancer in Lynch syndrome, and that is on the right side of the colon. But I can tell you that 120 or 22% went on to develop metachronous cancers, so that a quarter of the patients have had to subsequently undergo further surgery with the potential complications of doing further surgery and the potential of having missed tumors by colonoscopy. So from the literature, certainly, a colectomy with IRA or iliosigmoid anastomosis is the primary treatment. Consideration for less extensive surgery should be given to patients who are a little bit older to avoid repetitive abdominal surgery and to reduce the remaining amount of bowel to facilitate endoscopic surveillance. But that's not the end. That's really not the end, because it's really the patient who's going to decide what they want. If you're honest with the patient, can you tell the patient that they're going to have the same bowel function following a right hemicolectomy that they are with an iliorectal anastomosis or an iliosigmoid anastomosis? I believe that the results following an iliosigmoid and an iliorectal anastomosis are pretty consistent, but probably overall not as good. The bowel function's not as good as having a segmental resection. And further evidence for extended resection, you can see that this list of authors, in the years that they've looked at this problem, the number of patients, SEGC or segmental resections, and the number of metachronous tumors that have developed following segmental resection versus the number of metachronous tumors that have developed following more extended resection. And you can see from this, there's no question that you can see from this that the number of metachronous tumors that have developed are much less after an extended resection than after a segmental resection. It also is dependent on the gene, again. And I think with personalized medicine, we have to understand and know what we can say to the patient who's in front of us. If they have a particular pathogenic variant, then yes, maybe they are more likely to have extended surgery or have more segmental surgery. But this is a study that was done recently in 2017 showing the disease-free survival of MLH1 carriers and MSH2 carriers. And you can see that the graphs are almost exactly the same, showing that the disease-free survival in extended procedures is much greater than in lesser procedures. And the development of metachronous tumors is much greater, actually, in patients who have Lynch syndrome in red, which fits in with trying to do a more extended procedure. Maybe not as the index case, because you don't really know the status of that patient, but in certainly in all the follow-up cases in the family, you should aim for a more extended resection. And lastly, I will finish off with a few minutes about prevention. It's mainly chemo prevention. And it's the whole aspirin and story in Lynch syndrome. The CAP2 trial, it's a UK trial, colorectal adenocarcinoma prevention program. It's a randomized, double-blinded, placebo-controlled trial. initially, this was reported in Lancet in 2011, and they've been working on this for over 10 years now. But this was the first real report of the aspirin study in Lynch. Previous reports were with aspirin and adenomas. 937 individuals with Lynch syndrome, enterocoated aspirin, 600 milligrams per day versus placebo for a minimum of 2 years. No difference in colorectal polyps or cancer at the end of the intervention at 29 months, but a reduction of colorectal cancer and other Lynch syndrome-associated cancers in the long term, greater than close to 5 years. What's surprising in this particular study, which is a huge, huge multi-institutional study now, is that there were no adverse events in the ASA group. I find that hard to believe, but that is the result. You can see that in the for colorectal cancer, the aspirin group developed in 4.2%, the placebo group in close to 7%. And in the non-colorectal cancer, Lynch syndrome cancers, again, there was a marked effect of aspirin. Now that's been carried forward. The time to the first colorectal cancer in participants randomly assigned to aspirin, you can see that in this Kaplan-Meier analysis that there was a significant difference in the placebo versus the aspirin group, and time for the first Lynch syndrome non-colonic cancer in participants assigned to aspirin or placebo, the same kind of thing. When they did a subgroup analysis, particularly in obese patients, they found that there was an even more pronounced effect of the aspirin in the development of a reduction of colorectal cancer in the aspirin group. So the following, because 600 milligrams is a lot of aspirin to take, they have followed that up with the CAP3 study, which is still ongoing now, and is in 26 centers in the UK and around Europe in particular, and some centers in North America, where they have randomized it now into three different doses of aspirin, 600 milligrams, 300 milligrams, and 100 milligrams. Carriers of germline pathological MMR pathogenic variants, as I said, 26 centers. They are still recruiting. I've spoken to them in the last couple of weeks, and they're recruiting for another 6 months, and then they will analyze their data. The other studies that have been done with aspirin and Lynch syndrome, the colon cancer family registry, it's more of an observational study in close to 2,000 individuals with pathogenic germline MMR variants. It's a self-reported study. It's a little bit different, you can see also that there's a marked reduction in the likelihood of developing colorectal cancer with aspirin use. So there seems to be a fairly overwhelming evidence of the use of aspirin, particularly more so in Lynch syndrome than in the general population cancers. This is an Australian study that was done. It's not exactly the same kind of study. It's not just in Lynch syndrome, but 100 milligrams of aspirin daily versus placebo between 2010 and 2014. There were close to 20,000 individuals, but it was in healthy individuals with no cardiovascular disease, disability, or dementia, and all the patients in this particular study were greater than 70 years of age, and it was all causes of death. And they really didn't see a difference between the placebo and the aspirin group. This came out in the New England Journal of Medicine just about 3 weeks ago, and is a bit of a hit, I guess, towards the idea of aspirin causing a reduction of cancer, but it really, I think when you read it, you have to understand that it's a completely different group of patients that they were studying. Cancer was the major cause of death, and in fact, when they analyzed just the cancer deaths, they found that there were slightly more cancer deaths in that aspirin group than in the placebo group. So despite this study, which is not nearly the same, I think the evidence is fairly clear that at least in Lynch syndrome, that aspirin is a major factor in reducing colorectal cancer. So what can I say to summarize? The story of our family is, as we mentioned, not unlike other stories of other families, but I think that there is, as a doctor, as a surgeon, a responsibility not only to look after your patients, but to look after your families, and to know, going back to basics, to know what your family history is, and to see if there is any intervention that you can do as an individual surgeon to influence the outcome of what is going on in your own family. And I think that that one of the more important things that I think that I have done in my lifetime is to look after that family of ours. Whether they like me there, bugging them or not, I'm there. And I feel good about that. And I also feel good about the fact that we haven't lost anybody in the last 20 years since I've taken on that responsibility of following our family. It's ongoing, for sure. There are lots of lessons to learn from your family. It's interesting, and I think that I would recommend that you take some of what I'm saying to heart and look at the impact that you can have not only on your patients, which you have an impact on every single day, but on your family as well. The epidemiology is changing. It's very much changing in Lynch syndrome. And as I mentioned, I think we're going to see more of these pathogenic variants come up. Increased incidence of Lynch syndrome. Right now, 1 in 300 people will have a Lynch gene. Not always expressed, not always developing into a cancer. But I predict that we will know more about these risk associations over the next couple of years, particularly with multi-gene panel testing. Because if you do a multi-gene panel testing, let's say you're testing for BRCA gene. Well, when you do it on a panel, you're looking at all kinds of other genes as well. And that in itself will increase the incidence that we are seeing of these heritable syndromes that I'm talking about. The risk and surveillance guidelines, I think that we have to understand and know the associated Lynch tumors and understand that when a patient tells you that they have had endometrial cancer or they've had gallbladder cancer, it's not always the case that it's Lynch, but it should trigger something in you to tell you that this needs to be looked into in depth, looked into further, and make sure that you are doing the best for your patient by understanding all of these different cancers, understanding their associations, and either referring them or treating them or testing them in an appropriate way. The surgical options, as I said, there aren't many, but I do believe that a more extended procedure is what should be done in the majority of cases, although not everybody will want that, and of course it's the patient's decision what to do. And prevention, I do believe that we will hear over the next year what the real story is with aspirin at different doses. And so I would just like to thank our genetic counselors, five of them here, who have been there for all of our patients and helped me put together this talk, but also to Harden, who's our information technologist genius, who helped me in particular put the pedigrees together. And that was no easy task, and I hope that it was clear enough that you could understand the different branches of the family and relate to what I was saying. And to Herand, thank you for the honor and the privilege of giving this talk here today. I've known you for a very long time, and it is someone who I respect and always very affable, friendly, and it's a pleasure to be able to give this talk in your honor today. Thank you very much, and thanks everyone.
Thank you, Zane, and there's appreciation from the college and the society. Thank you very much for your lecture.
Thank you. Thanks very much.